First of all, your film wins Best Picture. Having a picture go from Sundance to Cannes.
Well, it's a new experience. It's never happened to me before. I think it's thrilling. I think it's thrilling for a number of reasons. One, that this film, which was very small when we started out, and we just thought it was going to be a wonderful experience, and it's a great script, suddenly has become the one that won Sundance. It was the sleeper, no one was talking about it, and hey, there it was, and it won the Writers' Award. And now here it is in Cannes, and I just think, you can dream sometimes, and dreams can come true, and that's what's great.
That's so true about Sunday, because I told you I was in Sundance, and there wasn't a lot of buzz about that film.
No, it's very quiet.
And in fact, when it won, people were saying, what was that film again? And what was that film again? Totally different scene here. I know you weren't at Sundance, but what's your take on the Cannes film?
Well, I've only been here for a day, and this is not the first time I've been to the Cannes Film Festival, but it's the first time I've been as a participant in terms of film. And it just seems to me to be the most energetic and connected film festival. I've been to the Berlin Film Festival. I had a film there a few years ago, and it was far more cool, and there was no central place like this, or all these places along the Croisette, where you could meet and flow and interconnect with people. It was very remote, and once your film was shown, you just evaporated into Berlin, and that was that. But this feels like very buzzy, very alive. I mean, I've only been here, 6 hours, and I've already seen a lot of people I know. I came into from the airport with two people I know from Australia, and that's really exciting, and I just wish I could stay longer.
In fact, didn't you say you shared a cabin and another...
Oh, I shared a cabin from my hotel to the Carlton with John Madden, who directed Mrs. Brown. Yeah, so someone else I know. So, and then I've met a couple of other people here since I came, I've known from the past. So I know that if you stayed here for longer than just 24 hours, just a day, I'd probably spend a lot of time saying hi to people I know. And I think that's good. And you get the feeling that there's a lot of people here making connections and making new relationships and deals and talking about the one thing that they all love, which is movies.
It's so interesting, though, because there are two such separate worlds. You know, there's the art of film people and the art of the deal people. You know, you've got all these creative people mixed in with all these deal makers, you know? In a way, it would seem that it's interesting that it brings them together.
But isn't Sundance like that as well?
Absolutely.
I mean, I guess anywhere where you've got something to market, and you have a market, you've got to have deal makers, don't you? Otherwise, there's no point in having a market.
Exactly.
The important thing would be to get the creative deal makers with the creative filmmakers, and then you get some really good films.
Tell me about Sunday.
Well, it's a very gentle story about two middle-aged people who are in a rather sad situation in their life. David's part is a man who was an executive at IBM who's been downsized, and he's ended up in a homeless shelter in New York. And my character is an out-of-work actress living in New York. He's had a good career there, came over to the Royal Shakespeare Company about 10 years previously and married an American. But things haven't gone well for her, and so she's just falling down this little endless tunnel that sometimes actors fall down. And she meets him on the street one Sunday, and she thinks he's a film director that she met in a festival, maybe, like, in London, actually. And he doesn't disabuse her of this idea, because he's fascinated by it. And he's got nothing to do, because there's nowhere to go on a Sunday for a homeless person except the streets. So the rest of the film explores what happens to these two disparate people who become engaged in a very intimate exploration of each other throughout the day.
Sounds like a sort of a meaty role, a very emotional.
Yes, it's a real part. It's funny, it's gentle, it's sad, it's full of despair, but it's a survivor. I mean, both of them are survivors. So in that sense, it's very human. They're real people, they're not something that... you would meet these people anywhere you went, in any place you went. They're not superheroes or imaginatively extraordinary people. They're not glorious or beautiful or evil. They're just human beings, and I think that's one of the strengths of the film.
When you come as an actress to the festival with a movie like Sunday, what's your best case scenario? What are your hopes? That people see it and like it, that a distributor picks it up? I mean, what sort of are your hopes for the movie? What do you guys hope to get out of it?
Well, we have distributors. I think they're hoping for foreign sales. We've got an American distributor. I think the thing to hope for is that whatever it is in this film that has touched the hearts of those who've seen it and who've loved it should reach out and touch a lot more hearts, and so that gradually an appetite for a different kind of film might emerge. I mean, it'd be wonderful if Sunday took off, because people keep saying it's different from any other film that's ever been made in America, because it's not a conventional American film. And it would be wonderful to think that out there in the world, there is a market for sensitive, gentle, funny, whimsical, off-the-wall films about human experience. Because that's really what I'm interested in doing as an artist. I mean, I don't want to do action movies. I want to do films that reveal what the experience of living is all about. Because we all go through this experience of living. We all have our hearts broken, have disappointments and have triumphs and have children and get married and, you know, and have jobs. We all do that. And yet we all treat it as if it's our own special thing that happens. And yet it's so amazing to sit and watch the experience that other people go through these things and learning from them. Saying, oh, yes, I remember being like that. Oh, well, maybe that's how I could deal with it next time or whatever.
Lisa, what's your take on this trend of movies surpassing the $100 million mark? I mean, even here we've got Fifth Element, which is here. Independent film, if you will.
It's costing that much.
It's supposed to. The person said $70 million, now they're saying $100 million.
What you say proceeds, you mean the money it's made or the money it costs?
The money it costs to make. What do you think of that? I mean, these huge budgets that films are demanding.
Well, I guess if someone's keen enough on the film to put that amount of money in, that's their lookout if they lose it. I mean, I know nothing about film finance, so maybe you're going to make $100 million
back. But some people are saying that's sort of a trend away from stories about people, which you're saying that you like.
Well, it has to be, doesn't it?
It's their special.
I wish we'd had $100 million. My God, I'd have. I could have been sitting here. I could have helicoptered in from London if I'd had. No, I mean, seriously.
Who would have ridden with them.
God, exactly. I mean, I think it's ludicrous, isn't it? But, you know, I suppose a market, if you're in a free market situation, the market will support what it can support. And if people are foolish enough to put that kind of money into a film and expect to get a revenue from it, until they learn from that it's a silly idea, it will continue. Or if maybe it's not a silly idea, maybe in the end, that's all we'll be left with. I hope not. But I think it's a waste of money myself. I've never seen that, but yes, I'm sure. Oh, no, I haven't. I mean, I'm not here tonight either, so. Yes, of course it's glamorous. That's glamorous. But that's glamorous because it's to do with the way that the industry presents it. And anyway, you see the queues out there. It's amazing. I'm amazed at the people queuing out in the rain and the cold to see another human being going past who they deem as a superstar. I mean, I had the same thing. I was out there filming. And Gerard Depardieu went to the back of my shot. And I was so, oh my God, it's Gerard Depardieu. And I went, oh, it's Lisa. I went, oh, Lisa, it's just Gerard Depardieu. But I mean, it's that, so yes, it has this kind of feeling, doesn't it? But I don't know, was Sundance not like that? No, there are no actors there, are there?
Much smaller actors.
Yes. No steps. No, mountains to climb, but no steps.
Yeah, mountains to fall down. I was actually sitting next to a Variety writer at the Spice Girls press conference today. He was saying Japan is almost like, it's almost like cult worship the way people are. The cult, the way people worship celebrities here. I mean, the crowds, Michael Jackson brings and the Spice Girls. People, as you said, queuing up in the rain for hours, you know? I mean, can you see that parallel?
The parallel of what?
Of like celebrity watching too. They're almost
yes,
like...
Yes, I suppose. I mean, a celebrity watching is something I don't understand. I've never understood why anyone would want to stand up and look at the Pope or the Queen or a celebrity. I mean, I find that very odd. But then I'm a girl who grew up without heroes, so, or role models. So I think if people want to do that, again, that's something that turns them on. Great. And it's good for the industry, obviously, and it's good. It makes Cannes a place that people have really seen it. And I'm doing this play in London, and they say, have a nice Sunday, and I said, I'm going to Cannes. And I went, oh my God, oh my. So, I mean, it has that kind of buzz, and that's great. And in the end, it's good for film, because in the end, that's what we're here for, isn't it? And if more independent films, more good movies, more intelligent, more interesting films come out of this, as well as the big blockbusters, that's wonderful. And the glamour and the high hype and the stardom and all that is all part of that, isn't it? It helps to nurture that whole feeling that we're dealing with something that's really exciting.
That was great. I'm happy with that. Are you good?
I'm fine.
You're such a good soundbite. Oh my God, there's so many to choose
from. I thought
it
was terrible.
She's so good. That was great. I'm good. That was great. I don't even think we need cover.